the next webinar in the Ideas to Action series that Practice My CFO is bringing to you. A very warm welcome to the 100-odd participants who have joined in today. It's a great pleasure for me to invite the panelists for today's session. Today we're going to be talking about raising equity in the new normal. So while a lot of the recent news, particularly after the finance minister's announcement, has been rightly focused on providing debt finance to MSMEs, our session today is really focused on what's happening in the equity markets. So firstly, let me first welcome a good friend, Srini from People Capital. Srini is unique in the sense that he's kind of been through the entire spectrum of angel investments, VC investments, and PE investments. He has been with Actis, with Intel, with Thomas Wiesel, with Lightspeed, and now he's currently with People Capital, where he's a partner. Going on next to Kalpesh, who is the Managing Director and CFO at Multiples Private Equity. Once again, welcome, Kalpesh. Very glad that you could join the session today. I'd now like to also invite Gitansh. Gitansh Bamania is the founder and CEO of RentoMojo. A disclaimer that all the comments that are being made here by the panelists or by myself, these are personal views and do not reflect the official view of the organizations that we may represent. Yeah, so if I can start with you first, Gitansh, if you can please kick off with your opening comments.
Opening comments on the question itself or sort of introduction, Venkat?
Really kind of share your views in terms of, you know, what is your sense and what is your experience of going about raising capital? You know, what is it that you're seeing in the market? Doesn't need to be necessarily restricted to RentoMojo. I mean, what are the kind of trends that you're seeing in raising capital today vis-a-vis what it was to raise capital, say, maybe 6 months or 1 year back?
Right. So I think some of the, and thanks for, you know, sort of organizing this, because, you know, I'll be able to, you know, share some sort of a snippets from the past 2 to 3 years, some sort of a dynamics of fundraising, because we raised in 2017, then 19, and now again. I think some of the prominent questions that are changing right now is, you know, there is a considerable shift that is happening towards, you know, profitability. So I think that's one change that I'm seeing now. For us, definitely, it was not a luxury, because we were, you know, just as an introduction, I think we work like any lending company. And instead of giving loan, we give out, you know, products like in the form of furniture and appliances to them and collect rental over it. So because we used to work like a lending company, and at the back there used to be a lot of lenders that we used to raise from, we always had to work on very strong fundamentals and very strong profitability to begin with. And I think that's something really helped us. Like just to give you a glimpse, I think some of the lending companies, I saw collections going down to, you know, 50 to 60%. For us, it stayed closer to about 95-96% even during the COVID time. So, you know, some of the strong fundamentals and our focus on building very profitable and focusing more towards EBITDA and PAT really helped us, at least convince. And definitely it was tough, specifically because we were supposed to raise and close the round by March. But things got accelerated because everyone was not sure how the post-COVID world would look like, but, you know, having strong fundamentals within these 3 months really helped us, and that's one of the, you know, core reasons why we were able to close, the round.
Got it. So the key takeaway seems to be that, look, some part of this was about the steps that you took, Gitansh, as a company, to be able to put yourself in a position where you could raise additional funding. And the other thing that you seem to be saying is the fact that you were already funded in the past, it kind of stood you in good stead when you went out to the market this time.
Yeah, I mean, when we went out to market, definitely, I mean, we were out. I mean, we were out for raising new funds in February itself. That delayed a little bit. But thankfully, we were able to close it.
Got it. Srini, if you could come to you and probably request you for your introductory remarks, please.
Thanks, Venkat. Once again, pleasure to be among this, all of us, and be sharing some of my experience with all of you. Absolutely. It's been, I mean, first of all, congratulations to Gitansh once again, as I was saying before, for rising next round and getting to a veritable position. In terms of just reflecting in the last 25 years of my journey as a VCP investor, yes, I've seen some of these ups and downs cycles. These are interesting times. These are also uncertain times, what we have been going through in the last 60 odd days. For most of us, I think it is the first time in our lifetime we would have gone through this experience, because this is something very dissimilar, or it's not similar to, let's say, a Great Depression or 2008 financial crisis, because they were largely financial markets driven headwinds, whereas this is something which is, seems to be hitting right across human behavior in a way it is influencing, as well as industries right through, maybe some of them more severely, some of them less severely. But I think it is not an anticipated, not a planned situation what we are getting ourselves accustomed to. Right? It is a dynamic situation. It is evolving situation. All of us are learning through that, adopting to that. Actually, maybe a fantastic time for us to, in terms of making ourselves much more stronger and resilient. Having said that, just reflecting as a PE investor in the industry for a very long time in India and seeing some of those trends outside too, let's also appreciate anything in a venture capital, private equity, it is a long-term allocation of capital. I think the decisions are not made in terms of what's happening in a month or 2 months and 3 months. It is a risk-adjusted, return expected fund allocation which happens on behalf of institutional investors. So there is a reason why people look at that. There is a fundamental business which makes difference in terms of why some certain business is getting funded, why it makes sense in terms of bringing those returns to the investors. There will be short-term cycles. There will be impact on the business, like what we have seen in commodity markets, right? There has been industry cycle in commodities, whether it's in auto, whether it is in telecom, whether it is in steel, cement. But fact of the matter is those cycles do pass out. And I think it's good to mention in my opening remarks, and I'm sure we'll be going through this in much little more detail, to say that PEVC is a long-term asset allocation. I think the underlying businesses make the difference in terms of those allocation, and the businesses have to be built to make sure that those nuances are taken care of.
Got it. Fair enough. So I think fundamentally what you seem to be saying, Srini, is that you're basically calling out the inherently risky nature of the investment, inherently long-term nature of the capital allocations that you're making. And you seem to be saying that, look, whether it's COVID or no COVID, I mean, that situation does not really kind of undergo a change. So if there is a business founder who's kind of looking to build an enterprise for the long term, or if you're a VC investor who is looking to kind of create wealth in the long term, the COVID situation is not necessarily kind of taken away from that basic premise.
I agree that. I think some of the things in terms of, like, the point is what Gitan said about the importance of cash and profitability were felt even before in multiple times pre-COVID too, right? So maybe we can discuss that a little later.
Sure, got it. Kalpesh, if I can come to you for your introductory remarks, please.
Thanks, Venkat. I would say, yes, as a PE investor, you look for really as a long-term investor, but I think in everyone's recipe, this particular event actually was not at all factored in that well as part of the recipe. And this has actually made quite a few companies, actually most of the companies and their investors, promoters, to re-look at businesses, looking at crisis management, business continuity plan, to really make it practical, workable, as against on books in all aspects. Earlier, BCP plan has been only about the IT system, or a crisis management has been about some particular news article or something. But I think this has to be really robust, implementable, and suddenly quickly implementable. That's what has actually happened there. But having said that, I would say that what in last 75 days, what I've seen is that our involvement with our portfolio company actually has gone up almost double the time what we used to spend, because companies are going through different kind of situation, maybe a crisis level of 10 to 1 to 10, and how they are managing it, how they're managing their people, their stakeholders, or their cash flow, working capital, or their strategy for next 3 months, 6 months, which is changing almost every week. That's been the scenario. We haven't anticipated this. In fact, the discussion what internally we have is that everyone's retirement period has actually increased by 1 to 2 years in overall scenario. That's the way you could actually look at it. But it's a good opportunity as an investor. I see it in next 1 year, whichever sector you look at, identify as part of your investment process. However, the deal process might become actually a cumbersome process and much, much rigorous process with the promoter companies. And I think the PEs now have realized that your involvement with the companies has to go further up, be it on operations, performance tracking, people aspects, governance, compliance. That's what is a big learning what we have figured out in this 75 days.